Adrian Zenz joins me now. He's a senior fellow in China Studies at the Victims of Communism Memorial Foundation. Good to see you, sir. Tell me, what is the most important lessons that can be taken from these documents? What pressure might they apply?
The documents give us unprecedented detail behind the reasons of why the Uyghurs have been put into re-education camps and the reasoning behind whether they should be released or not. They give details about three generations of family members and social circles, and also about the so-called religious inheritance circle, meaning how did somebody find out about praying before meals, about going to a mosque? This is the level of detail that we're speaking about here.
Mm. You know, of course, so what does that do to China's narrative, which is, of course, that it's about de-radicalization, it's about fighting terror? How valid does that argument sound in the face of what we've learned?
The evidence that we have gathered from this new leaked document indicates that China is really trying to control an entire ethnic group by placing them under a general blanket of suspicion. A lot of the people in the document were simply interned for no specific reason, but simply for being labeled untrustworthy. Mm-hmm. Others were simply said to have been grown up in a family with a religious atmosphere, or they have caught a minor religious infection, quote unquote. So it's almost like an ideological witch hunt. It's almost like a medieval attempt to stomp out a religion that the state is afraid of.
You know, I guess that sort of begs the question, how effective can such actions be? I mean, you would imagine it's unlikely to make Uyghurs magically sympathetic to the Chinese government.
The system is based on fear, and it is replacing trust with control. It's about intimidation. It's about scaring people away from anything religious. It's about creating an atmosphere of preemptive obedience, where you try to make sure to obey every whim of the state rather than risking internment. But obviously, can we call this system successful? Maybe on the surface, maybe in the short run. But the long-term implications are ones of high risk and possibly great social instability.
What other risks do you mean?
The risk of radicalization. Basically, by treating people this way, Beijing is risking to turn completely normal, healthy citizens into hateful, resentful persons who one day might be liable to be influenced by radical ideas out of hate, hurt, resentment, and revenge.
Yeah, and you know, you've got the locking up of as many as a million people in these camps. That's obviously the priority issue at stake. But what's also worrying, I suppose, is the evidence that we've seen of the destruction of Uyghur neighbourhoods, the sort of purging of the region's culture and mosques and so on.
Yes, the Chinese state is exercising control on a number of levels. It has destroyed mosques. It has destroyed neighbourhoods. The main reason is to place people under greater control. China often wants its minorities to move to urban areas where they're easier to be controlled by the government. This also includes Tibetans. In order to do so, China is changing entire neighborhoods in order to bring them closer to where the government can keep an eye on them.
It's extraordinary. I mean, the reality, though, when it comes to action from the world outside of China's borders, you know, there have been words of, you know, concern and some criticism and so on, but there's been no real action, has there? Why is that?
It is unfortunately incredible to see the extent and the sway that Beijing has over other countries in terms of its economic power. No country, not even Western countries, are risking Beijing's wrath and its revenge for those who speak out against its human rights record. China has found a way to manipulate the world and even to co-opt the United Nations into supporting what it is doing, even interning a million or more Muslims and even getting almost 20 Muslim countries to sign a letter condoning this policy.
Wow. Adrian Zenz, we'll have to leave it there, but thank you so much for speaking with us and the work that you do.
Thank you.